From the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum in Cleveland, Ohio, it's Paul Simon and John Mayer. This is In Tune, presented by Bailey's.
Yeah. Hello, Cleveland. Welcome. All right, so you got an idea of who I am. I'm Randy Jackson, right? Listen, I just want to welcome you. You're about to see an amazing, amazing show tonight. We got two extraordinary singer-songwriters connected by their music, and for the first time, connecting in person, Mr. Paul Simon and John Mayer. Tonight, you'll have a front row seat to hear Paul and John tell stories you've never heard them tell before, pay homage to their biggest influences, and share the stage for some unbelievable performances. So, yo, let's just get it on right here. We're gonna start, without all the talking, we're gonna start with a little insight on Mr. John Mayer through the eyes of Paul Simon. Check it out.
He's an excellent player. He's a really good player. He's fast. He's equipped to make extraordinary statements. Welcome to the real world, she said to me, condescendingly. He was coming to my apartment. He was completely at ease, self-assured. He played some new songs for me. I played some new ones for him. He was playing a Martin, a John Mayer model Martin, and I was playing a Paul Simon model Martin. I was enjoying it. He studied at Berkeley, so he plays a really nice rhythm, acoustic rhythm. The question is really then, after you have the chops, you know, what does the mind give you to make it your music? For a lot of songwriters, I think the first impulse that you have is often a hit. John had that with Your Body's a Wonderland, which was a very good record as well, as being, you know, a very hooky song. Your body is a wonderland. He seemed so, you know, bright and aware and so interested. And, you know, he loves what he does. He just seems like a, you know, I mean, he seems like a songwriter to me. Seems like, I know the type. I know it well.
Ladies and gentlemen, John Mayer.
Come now, this is bound to be a while.
Paul Simon through the eyes of John Mayer.
I was introduced to Paul Simon through my older brother, and I would just hear this music over and over again. I remember thinking that anything he liked wasn't cool. And then after a while, I was like, I can't be mad at you. This stuff is actually really, really good. There's something magical about Paul's music because he can describe places to you so well that you feel as if you've been there. Very specific writer, almost a screenwriter for music. We like to know a little bit about you for our time. The first time I ever saw Simon and Garfunkel, it was their live performance at Central Park. And I think that was my first exposure to, like, seeing all these people respond to just two guys, just music. That's a testament to their tunes, you know? Because there wasn't any slick production. It was just heart. Parsley, sage, rosemary. The song like Scarborough Fair, when I first heard it, was so eerie almost, so profound it was eerie, what I call scary good. It's such a wonderful sadness. And I think that's something that always goes through Paul's music, is a wonderful sadness.
I met my old lover on the street last night.
I went to Berklee College of Music, and that's when I kind of rediscovered Negotiations and Love Songs. And I thought, okay, this is what I want to do. I want to find that musical space inside of pop songs.
Slip sliding away.
And all the songs on Room for Squares are incredibly influenced by the Paul Simon style of don't waste a drop of language. Paul Simon, to me, is equal measure incredible novelist, incredible singer, incredible interpreter of melody, and also incredible guitar player. It's something about that music goes straight to your heart.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Paul Simon.
For my destination, on a tour of one night stands, my suitcase and guitar in hand, and every stop is neatly planned for a poet and one man band homebound. An endless stream of cigarettes and magazines. Each town looks the same to me, the movies and the factories, and every stranger's face I see reminds me that I long to be homeward bound. Oh, I wish I was homeward bound. Silently for me. Tonight I'll sing my songs again. I'll play the game and pretend. But all my come back to me in shades of mediocrity, like emptiness and harmony. I need someone to comfort me. I wish I was homeward bound, home where my thoughts escape, and at home where my music's playing, and home where my love lies waiting silently for me. Silently for me.
This is In Tune, presented by Bailey's. Bailey's reminds you to indulge responsibly. On in their music, please check out baileysintune.com.
Welcome back to In Tune. So by the age of 25, you guys both had gold records. I mean, Paul, I mean, you didn't have just one. I mean, you had like three.
Well, first of all, you only had to sell like 200-300 copies to get a gold
record.
That
time, right?
Back
yeah.
in the day. Wasn't that big a deal.
So, John, what about you, dude? I mean, you know, you had a gold record at such a young age. I mean, how did that make you feel? What did you think? Were you like...
Milestones are fantastic ways of processing, like, all the things you can't see for yourself.
Right.
I'm colossally bad at doing that, so I need numbers and positions and chart positions, I should say. And I need those things to show me that I'm doing all right.
You know? All right, so let me ask you something. Talking about influences and the things that, you know, inspired you guys and moved you. When did your love affair with Elvis start?
My literal love affair with Elvis started.
yeah, take us down the literal road. Yes, yes.
My first recollection of Elvis Presley, I was in the back seat of my parents' car. I was lying down, and they were going grocery shopping. The radio was on, and an announcer said, "Now here's a singer," and they say every time he sings in the South, there are riots. And his name is Elvis Presley, which I thought was absolutely the strangest name I had ever heard. I did love the Elvis Presley sound, and particularly I liked Mystery Train, which is my favorite record. My favorite record in rock and roll is Mystery Train.
John, I hear that you wanted to actually be a DJ at some point. But you got really turned on and influenced by Stevie Ray Vaughan. So.
Yeah, not DJ, but I used to...
Use an actual radio voice? This is John Mayer.
No, I knew how to I knew how to push my Adam's apple out whenever I really wanted to get hit. You know, I was like...
So how did you get from that to Stevie Ray? What was it about Stevie Ray when you heard...
Well, I don't know what it was about Stevie Ray, because there wasn't anything in my life that had predicated that kind of love before. And for the first time in my life, I said, I want what this is, yeah. I want what's to the left and right of it, I want what's behind it, and I want what it's leading to.
So now, how did you get from Stevie Ray to Hendrix? I mean, you know, they're in the similar family, I guess.
Yeah.
I'm sure Stevie was inspired by Hendrix, obviously.
Absolutely. You know, it's funny, your hero has a hero, you
right.
know?
Right.
When you really love something, and I think everybody can share a story like this, you find something you really love, and you love everything associated with it. So. Anything I heard, it kind of became this almost genealogical kind of hunt for your family. You know, you hear Stevie Ray Vaughan, and what is Stevie Ray Vaughan like? Well, he loves Jimi Hendrix. Well, then right. I got to get me some Jimi Hendrix.
Right, right.
The thing about real music is that people, more than just being willing to talk about it, feel compelled to direct their listeners to the real deal.
Yeah. All right, let's get back to the stage. Let's hear some music. For the first time ever, Paul Simon, John Mayer.
Side of the road, a bright light shattering the shop windows, the bomb and the baby carriages wired to the radio, and these are the days of miracles.
wonder. This is the long distance call. The way the camera follows us in slow-mo. The way we look to us all, oh yeah. The way we look to a distant constellation that's dying in a corner of the sky. These are the days of miracle and wonder. So don't cry, baby, don't cry, don't cry. Across the desert and curled into the circle of earth. And the dead sand falling on the children and the mothers and the fathers and the automatic earth. These are the days of miracle and wonder. This is a long distance call. The way the camera follows us in slow-mo. The way we look to a star, oh yeah. A hero up the pop charts. Medicine is magic, magical is art. The boy in the bubble, the baby with the baboon heart. These are the lasers in the jungle, lasers in the jungle somewhere. Staccato signals of constant information, a loose affiliation of millionaires and billionaires. And these are the days of miracle and wonder. This is the long distance call. The way the camera follows us in slow-mo. The way we look to us all. The way we look to a distant constellation that's dying in a corner of the sky. These are the days of miracle and wonder. Don't cry, baby, don't cry, don't cry, don't.
TNT in HD makes high-definition drama a reality.
Brain in the Distance? For more pics and clips, log on to baileysintune.com.
Nice little story.
So, okay. Paul, that's an amazing song. But Indelible?
Yeah.
My
mom's an English teacher.
Really?
And so I was always brought up on, you know, the wonder of words, for lack of a more
phrase. That's a big one. That's a big one. Yeah, it's a big one.
For lack of a more masculating phrase, the wonder of words. And I just remember getting, what does indelible mean? And finding out and then kind of throwing that in somewhere along the line.
So the writing of music. Paul, what is first for you, music or lyrics? Or let's talk about the writing process just a little bit.
Well, I started writing songs when I was about 12, 12, 13. I made my first record when I was 15.
Wow.
But I used to just do it the way, I'd sit with a guitar, the way most guitar writers do it.
And you have a lyric.
Play the guitar and sort of make up a song. And I don't think I ever had a lyric in front, although I do keep a notebook with thoughts or phrases or images and
that you'd like to put in.
Yeah, and if there's a time when it's appropriate, then I take them out of the book and insert it into the song.
John, what about you? Music or lyrics first? I mean, how's your process?
It's pretty similar. I'm always kind of thinking about topics. I think a good tune can start from anywhere, but a good song comes from a topic. I feel like when you first hear a song, it's just a track, and you want to sing over it.
Right.
I oftentimes feel like whatever you first come up with is the truth.
That's the thing.
You just have to make the truth sound like English.
Right.
You
exactly.
Know? That's the hard part.
Have it make sense?
Know? Yeah. I mean, think about all the greatest tunes in the world, and think about if they sounded different. What if it wasn't Like a Virgin, Miss You Baby, Miss You Baby? It'd be like, what's that?
Right.
You know.
Right.
It wouldn't work. It's the lack of and it's kind of like the mouth is a drum set. Everybody loves the sound of a train in the distance. It's like you don't have to speak English to listen to that and go, you know, that's amazing.
Is that your favorite Paul song?
I think so. I think it's the economy of that song is brilliant.
So great, yeah.
It's 3-4 verses, and you feel as if people's hair is getting longer,
right,
you know, getting wrinkles.
Right, right.
I don't know how, they're just words, and I think he's got some mojo going on with those words. You know?
Mojo, I like that.
Yeah.
So speaking of writing songs and doing songs and everything, we promised this crowd some more playing. Why don't you guys get up and do one of your songs, John?
Okay.
What about some more music, right?
Thank you. problem is I'm singing Still Crazy after all these years in a turkey outfit.
Yeah. How does this feel, Scotty?
It's very painful.
Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You're great.
You're great.
Still crazy after all. Forget it.
Joe, welcome back. Welcome back. Listen, Paul, man, I got to know about the turkey suit, dude. How'd they talk you into doing that, man?
The turkey suit was my idea, but he belonged to somebody who's about John's size. And if you can find a way to get yourself in the turkey suit,
do it.
You know, with some logic, everything that you say from that point on is just going to be right.
All right, but wait a minute. So, were there any other animal suits you wanted to be in? Was turkey the only one?
Oh, now you're like opened a whole, I'd rather not talk about that.
Great moments. I mean, you know, talking about the connections between you two guys. So, John, you were on SNL, right?
I was on it, yeah. Everybody knows now that, you know, Saturday Night Live's run in perpetuity, you know? So you better play your ass off because people are going to be watching it, yourself included, like on Thanksgiving when they run the marathon. So do it as well as you can do it.
It had such a depth of talent. It was really extraordinary. Like the musical director in the first seasons was Howard Shore, you know,
who just
won 3 Oscars for Lord of the Rings for, right, you know, he's the composer of the...
So things didn't quite pan out for him after the show.
Had a little tough time later on. All right, so let me ask you something. So, Paul, we've got proof of some pictures here that we could tell that you wanted to be a rock star at a very early age of 12.
Yeah, that was sort of New York juvenile delinquent started.
Yeah, it was hot, though, man. Paul, it was so hot, man. It looked cool, man.
It was cool. Well, it wasn't that cool.
You know what's funny about this is I think all of us were influenced by something, right? I hear that, John, you, at a very young age, had some Michael J. Fox story. There's something about a letter, something about a hair, something.
You know,
what was this? Explain this.
I was a huge fan of Michael J. Fox. If you were born in 77, you were kind of like, you know, you loved his hair. He was just a cool guy,
right.
You know, and I wanted to have hair like I went for it. I think you can see I was going
for it.
Hey,
you look just like him, dude. You
no
and
one's
Michael
ever
J,
seen
dude.
This picture before, by the way. I was almost, I thought I wanted to be an actor for about 6 months.
Because of Michael.
I just thought he was the coolest thing in the world, you know. I picked up a guitar in the first place because of, you know, that big scene at the end of Back to the Future, the big coming out scene with Johnny B. Goode. And this, you know, little short kid says, you know, it's in B flat and watch me for the changes and try to keep up, you know?
All right,
and
listen,
you knew it wasn't it wasn't in B flat too.
No, it wasn't.
But yeah, he's calling it out. Here we go. It's in B flat.
He's calling out the changes.
It's not in B flat.
I wrote him a fan letter. I got so crazy about the hair, which we now call a mullet these days, but it really was actually...
Dude, but it was going on
was
around
great.
That time,
and
dog.
Listen, you know, Michael J. Fox had a wonderful thing going on with the hair, and I wrote him a letter asking how he got the hair like that, and I'm still waiting for the reply.
All right, well, listen, there's enough talking, man. Let's get back to the stage. Let's hear some music. Paul Simon, John Mayer.
Sure.
What is it, 4 a.m. or 5? I don't know. Yeah. This is like, all artists have the bad dream that they're still playing at 4 a.m. and people have it. There's like 4 people left, they're like, one at a time, they're like, I gotta go. And meanwhile, we haven't played the first note because for some reason everything's wrong. Plug the jack in and the string breaks and then put the microphone up and the guitar falls. You ever had those dreams?
Oh, well, I've had that reality.
Sliding away. You know, the nearer you destination, the more your slip sliding away. I know a man, he came from my hometown. He wore his passion for his woman like a thorny crown. He said, Dolores, I live in fear. My love for you so overpowering, I'm afraid that I will disappear. Slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know you're near your destination, the more you slip sliding away. These are the very words she uses to describe her life. She said a good day ain't got no rain. She said a bad day's when I lie in bed and think of things that might have been. Slip sliding away, slip sliding. Destination, the more you slip sliding away. To tell him all the reasons for the things he'd done. He came a long way just to explain. He kissed his boys, he lay sleeping, and then he turned around and he headed home again. Slip sliding away, slip sliding away. The near your destination, the more you slip sliding away. God only knows. God makes his plan. The information's unavailable to the mortal man. We're working our jobs, collect our pay. Believe we're gliding down the highway, in fact we're slip sliding away. Slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know you're near your destination, the more you slip sliding away.
Is In Tune, presented by Bailey's. Bailey's reminds you to indulge responsibly. All right, vocal category. Paul for his song Still Crazy After All These Years, and John for Your Body is a Wonderland. Get exclusive picks and clips from tonight's show at baileysintune.com.
Welcome back to In Tune.
All right, so check this out. So you guys got this last song you're going to play, right?
It's got like this sick, crazy, cool bass line, man.
We don't have a bass player, though.
Dude, are you looking for a bass player? I mean, come on, Paul.
I'm looking everywhere for a bass. You can't find a bass player just like that. Not a great bass player.
I know, man. There might be a guy, man, that might want to get up, man. That's always wanted to jam with you.
Yeah.
And you.
I wish it were so, but we can't find him.
Dude, I mean, yeah, I play a little bit every now and then. You know what I mean? You think I...
A little bit of what?
I play a little bit of bass. I know I'm on this crazy wild show, but
we're looking for
I play a little bit of bass, man. You think I could join you guys?
Join us for what?
Not lunch. I mean, the jam on this song, dude.
Oh.
Come on.
You were great playing before. Not really. But you were...
Whoops. Hey, what's going on up
now
here?
Now I'm up.
Yeah, now we're awake, right? Yeah. Hey, let's go.
No, that'll be fun. That'll be good.
Oh, thanks, dude.
Yeah, come on.
I finally get a chance to jam with Paul. This is great. This is great. I'll join you up there in a moment. Okay. All right, really quick, before we get started, with tonight's last song that they've allowed me to come up and jam with them on, I'd like to thank Bailey's. I'd like to thank the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum and the fine people of C-Town. Yeah! And of course, most importantly, I'd love to thank Paul Simon, John Mayer, for a truly unforgettable evening. I am Randy Jackson, and remember, stay tuned to Intune. But for now, it's time for some more music. I'm gonna go join them. musician. What else?
I kind of wanted to be a comedy writer for a long time. I like the idea of being a writer for like Conan O'Brien or something.
Tell me about your fondest SNL memories.
The first time I met Chevy Chase, he was walking across a room and he started to say,